As Russia's military assault of Ukraine is underway, Germany's top diplomat put it in stark terms. We woke up in a different world today. CNN's Matthew Chance is on the front lines, and I want you to watch what he and his crew came upon only 20 miles outside of Kyiv.
And we are here at the Antonov Airport, which is about 25 kilometers, 15 miles or so out of the center. These troops you can see over here. Stand up, Lewis. These troops you can see over here, they are Russian airborne forces. They have taken this airport. They've allowed us to come in and be with them as they defend the perimeter of this airbase here, where helicopter-borne troops, these troops, were landed in the early hours of this morning to take and to form an air bridge to allow for more troops to come in. You can see these are Russian forces. You can tell they're Russian. I've spoken to them already. You can tell they're Russian. They've got that orange and black band to identify them as Russian forces. I've spoken to the commander on the ground there within the past few minutes, and he said they are now in control of this airport. And within the past few seconds, just before you came to us, they were engaged in a firefight, presumably with the Ukrainian military, which says it is staging a counter-offensive to try and take back this airport. But I can tell you now, I'm standing outside the perimeter of this Antonov airbase, and it has not been taken back by the Ukrainian military. It is the Russian military. You can see them now moving back to a different position. It is the Ukrainian military who say they are now in control. This is about, I would say, about 20 miles from the center of the Ukrainian capital. And so it just shows us now, for the first time, just how close Russian forces have got towards the center of the Ukrainian capital. It's not just, I was speaking to officials earlier, Ukrainian officials, and they're saying that the plan isn't just to surround the Ukrainian capital. They fear now that the plan is to take the capital, to decapitate the leadership of Ukraine, and to replace that leadership with a pro-Russian government. That's what Ukrainian officials are telling us now. They think is the Russian plan. And I can tell you, it is a very tense situation. We're expecting to see Ukrainian military force. We didn't even know, frankly, we didn't even know that, you know, the Russian forces were going to be here. We assumed this was the Ukrainian forces. So I went up to speak to them saying, hey, we've come from Kyiv, you know, but it only emerged during the conversation that they're all Russians and there are no Ukrainian military forces in sight, although I can hear them because they've been shooting ferociously in the course of the past few minutes. And so we're sort of in the defensive position behind this wall here. You've got our car here with the crew here as well. You know, as the Russian airborne troops defend this position that they've taken on the outskirts of Kyiv.
Unbelievable. I mean, what Matthew Chance is seeing and all of the images that are coming out of Ukraine depict a surreal scene, war in Europe. Russian President Vladimir Putin upending decades of geopolitical stability overnight when he decided to unprovoked launch attacks on multiple locations across Ukraine. Moments ago, a statement was just put out from the G7 leaders condemning Vladimir Putin, saying, quote, he has put himself on the wrong side of history. Joining me right now is CNN political and national security analyst David Sanger, the author of The Perfect Weapon, War, Sabotage, and Fear in the Cyber Age. Very important issue right now, specifically in what we're talking about, David. No matter, David, how this ends, do people across the globe need to start considering that this will impact and change security worldwide, including for Americans?
Oh, I think our world has changed today. Just as the German foreign minister said, I think she had it just right. And I think that's true for a couple of reasons. First of all, Kate, if you and I had been on the air a year ago and would have tried to lay odds on the thought that there would be a war in Europe unprovoked in which a rising European democracy, a flawed one, a corrupt one, but one for which there was hope, was taken over by a superpower, I don't think either one of us would have given that much chances. The second is, listening to Matthew Chance and his incredibly brave and great work out there, think about this. He's telling us Russian forces are 20 miles from Kyiv. And that in itself tells you, you know, people just this morning were thinking that would be a few days, maybe a week. I think the third big thing we have to think about for this is that we have gone from a world in 15 years where we were discussing Russia as a potential partner, even talking about whether they might join NATO, to one in which the country and its leader are an outcast. I don't think it's very long before you hear people discuss, we've heard some already, whether or not this is a war crime that's gone on, because there was nothing to provoke it. There was this sort of big lie that Ukraine was seeking nuclear weapons, that it was planning genocides. All of it was nonsense. And so we have a lot to reevaluate. And then the cyber element you discussed, maybe what's coming.
I want to get to that in a second. But so Biden's going to announce new sanctions in just minutes. Why didn't sanctions work to stop Putin?
It's a great question. I mean, the oddity of this case is, in this particular time, Kate, is that we had near perfect intelligence. We've had other cases where we've had big intelligence failures. Here, the intelligence agencies were on it early. They analyzed it correctly. They told skeptical Europeans, hey, this isn't a bluff. We think he is getting ready to actually wage war and take back Ukraine. Even the Ukrainians didn't believe that until just a few days ago. And yet our deterrence effort failed because at the end of the day, we couldn't come up with a penalty for President Putin that seemed to him to be worse than not restoring part of the old Soviet empire. And in the end, for deterrence to work, the target of it has got to want one thing or avoid a penalty greater than they want their strategic objective. And we didn't come up with that.
Let's talk about cyber. Mark Warner, the senator, was on earlier and talking about how cyber attack aspect of this has only just begun. Let me play what he said.
If the Russians launch a more massive cyber attack and, for example, try to shut down all the power in Ukraine, you can't control once you unleash cyber weapons, malware, by geographic locations. That cyber attack could bleed into Eastern Poland, where there are American troops, or it could shut down a Polish hospital.
David, what do you think of that? I mean, is that then an attack on NATO?
It's a great question. I think the senator had it exactly right. You know, when you're doing physical attacks of the kind that are playing out on our screen, horrific and brutal as they are, you can control the boundaries that they're in. The nature of cyber attacks is they frequently go outside the boundaries you intended them for. And particularly the case with the Ukrainian electric grid, which is connected both back to Russia and to parts of Europe, certainly communications grids. So there's lots of reasons to think it could spill over. And some of the biggest cyber attacks, including in Ukraine, the NotPetya attack that was the most expensive one, took out Federal Express and Maersk and others, went way beyond Ukraine's borders inadvertently. And then NATO's got to say, you know, is this now an attack on NATO issues? Because NATO has said cyber attacks can also be regarded as an attack. I think they would be hesitant to get in the middle of a war and let that escalate with Russia, but it's certainly a big issue.
That's the danger. That's why this is just beginning in how dangerous this really is. David, thank you so much.